So there's actually a big gap between what we think of, you know, as scientific performance, dynamic range, and all that, and our understanding of the engineering specifications. So at events like this, you can really tell that the engineers and the scientists don't quite have a common language. And it's also quite difficult to make progress analytically on this issue. It's just, you know, interferometry is so difficult that working things out with pen and paper is really, really hard, although a few people have made significant progress. Funnily enough, they're all sitting in this room right now. So our project takes a kind of a different approach to this. The context for beam sims is basically comparing, the original scope of the project was comparing the dish designs that were available from EARCAT. So as you know, CAT 7, the Pathfinder, uses a classical prime focus dish design. And for EARCAT itself, also Gregorians were adopted. So our work tries to kind of sort of after the fact actually measure that decision and the impact of that decision on scientific performance. And we do it through simulations, right? So if you cannot make progress analytically, do simulations, because then at least maybe you'll be able to understand something. Here's a picture of the suspects. So these were produced by EMSS. You've heard the name today already. These are fully EM simulations of the primary beam pattern for the offset Gregorian here and the prime focus here. Now these go out to 90 degrees, right? So your actual field of view is that little dot in the middle here. And the rest of it, all you're seeing here is side lobes rendered in a log scale, so they're nowhere near as bad. This is a log scale. And when you kind of look at this, it's a bit of a pick your poison situation,
what is,
right?
What is the power scale? What's the dynamic range?
I can't remember. But basically, looking at it just like that, it's kind of difficult to say whether, you know, whether this is better than that. I mean, this is at least nice and symmetric. This is asymmetric. On the other hand, you've got these big things going here. These are, of course, associated with the struts, with the aperture blockage, these patterns here. And the reason for the vertical asymmetry is because I think I've just plotted one polarization here, instead of the vertical or the horizontal.
So why are they not symmetric for stresses? It should be along
because
the vertical.
Because this is just the age response. So this is just one element of the drone matrix, and that makes for a difference in the vertical symmetry. So anyway, it's kind of a pick your poison situation until we get deeper into the subject. So then let's think about dynamic range. What actually limits dynamic range? And I've tried to make a bit of a laundry list. So of course, the first limit is thermal noise. And well, thermal noise, we can work out quite easily what the thermal noise should be for any given observation. But of course, as you all know, we are consider ourselves lucky if we can ever reach it in any given observation. Sometimes we do, most of the time we don't. We're actually limited by something else. The second limit is classical confusion. That's also fairly easy to work out. That's basically, if you know the resolution of your instrument, then you pretty much know how faint you can get before the sources get too crowded. So that's another fundamental limit. That's given by resolution. And that's another one that we can work out fairly easily. The subject of this talk will be these two. So the first limit here is the side lobe confusion noise. So this is all the extra signal that comes in through your primary beam side lobes. It's signal you're not interested in, more or less by definition, but it's there anyway. So that could provide a limit on dynamic range. And the second limit on dynamic range is residual calibration artifacts, or what we sometimes call calibration noise. And these things, as I will show, they will certainly depend on properties of the beam shapes. So we can use simulations to quantify these two. So that's the two big themes I'm going to try to cover. So the first one is side lobe confusion noise. What's side lobe confusion noise? Well, comes about because our point spread function of the interferometer is in principle unbounded, right? It never actually quite goes to zero. So no matter in which direction you look, you're still going to get some interferometric signal from a source over here. And at the same time, your primary beam pattern is also not entirely zero, right? You have side lobes, you have distant side lobes. So for any given source, in principle, there's going to be a non-zero contribution to your field of view from every single source in the sky, right? It's just a very small contribution thanks to the PSF and thanks to the primary beam. Otherwise, we wouldn't be able to do interferometry at all, right? So that's the three factors that attenuate distant sources. You have your BSF side lobes, your primary beam side lobes, which sort of go to zero and not quite. And then there's time and bandwidth smearing. Of course, from low far, from Westerport low frequency experience, we know quite well already that the brightest ATEM sources are almost always visible. So I actually have some wonderful images of Cygnus A I've made with Westerbork when it's 90 degrees away. So it's kind of Westerbork is an all-sky instrument, really. But when we get to the sort of sensitivities we worry about with SKA, it's not just the ATEM that you have to worry about, because presumably these guys we can take care of with direction-dependent solutions or whatever on a case-by-case basis. You can probably deal with these guys. But at the scale sensitivities, you start worrying about the mass of fainter sources that are going to start coming through. And there's too many of them to deal with them individually. So what are they going to do to you? Well, what they do to you is that there's no such thing really as an empty field. Even if you did find a patch of sky that was completely empty of useful signal, it's still going to have signal in it. So what does this translate into? So you image a piece of sky, you've deconvolved it to a certain radius, R0. Let's say you have a perfect deconvolution algorithm, which we know doesn't exist, but let's say you have one. Even then, you're still going to have, for any given pixel, you're still going to have a non-zero contribution from every single source outside your image. It's going to be non-zero, and there's so many of them that this contribution is going to be a kind of a Gaussian noise term. And that term is absolutely fundamental, right? It's not going to go away from integrating because the sources are still there. So you can integrate as long as you want. You can drive down your thermal noise as deep as you want. You're still going to have that signal from all those sources outside the image. So the only thing you can do about it is, well, you can make a bigger image, and you can involve more sources, and then you can drive this thing down. And at the limit, in principle, you can get to imaging the whole sky. But this becomes a serious cost driver, right? Because it's expensive to image and deconvolve so much sky. And the other problem, I'll touch on this a little bit later, there's if you just have a single pointing, if you don't have an external LSM, then the sources contributing the signal, they're also going to sink to the noise. So how do you deconvolve them if you can't even recover them in the first place? So the question we're trying to address, do primary beams influence side lobe confusion noise? Well, of course they do, because primary beam side lobes are a modulator of side lobe confusion noise. So the question is, how do we estimate this, how do we quantify this, and how do we get a performance metric out of this? Can we use this to, you know, to say some hard facts about different beam shapes? So that brings me to BeamSims. So the strategy of BeamSims is basically kind of a brute force interferometric simulation. So we use the NVSS to provide us with a realistic all-sky LSM. And this is actually no longer true, going for the lower cutoff. We use part of the NVSS for performance reasons, to keep the source counts reasonable. And then we kind of extrapolate. And we use SCADs basically to derive a correction factor. So let's say you only put sources brighter than half a Jansky into your simulator. How much flux are you missing out on? Well, that you can derive from the SCAD simulations. You can derive a correction factor. Turns out most of the signal actually comes from these guys. The fainter sources don't contribute so much, which is good news. And then we have a set of full EM primary beam, simulated primary beam patterns provided by EMSS. So these things are actually, they're sort of like images, except we get them in spherical coordinates. And they give us the beam pattern all the way out to 90 degrees in steps of, well, basically as fine as we wanted. We use a range of steppings. We use a finer stepping for the main lobe, and then coarser steppings of half a degree or degree for the side lobes. And those things are actually the images of the primary beam that you saw before. Those are the EMSS simulations. And then we put it all together into a framework and make trees, and there's a bit of code there now that basically for every source, it just keeps track of where that source is in the primary beam patterns and interpolates the beam gains, interpolates all four elements of the drone's matrix for every single source, and then puts it all together and gives us all visibilities. So then the next thing we do what I call donut local sky models. So we split the sky into rings, into concentric rings. And then we run separate simulations. So for each ring, we simulate all the sources sitting in that ring. And then we make an image of the empty sky in the center, right? So because we haven't put anything into the center of the simulation, there shouldn't be any signal there. But there is, of course, because that's the side lobe confusion noise from the sources in this ring, right? So then we just measure the RMS pixel value in the sky image of the middle that we've made, and then we say, okay, this RMS pixel value is exactly the side lobe confusion noise contribution from ring number I, right? And just for reference, a typical simulation for Meerkat, you'd be looking at a few thousand LSM sources and 2,000 baselines. And it's not unreasonable. It's only about half an hour to an hour to run this whole thing for, let's say, for one ring. So it takes a few hours to make a full Meerkat simulation, and people hate me and they deny my processes, but it's not too bad. And then you put it all together, and you end up with something that we call the cost curve. So let me explain this plot. Along this axis, you have radius. And along this axis, you have the side lobe confusion noise from, for every point, this shows the aggregate signal from all sources outside that radius, right? So another way to read this off is, let's say I image out to 5 degrees, make an image that's 10 by 10 degrees. I'm going to be missing all the sources from 5 degrees on out. How much side lobe confusion noise are they going to contribute into the middle of my field? So that's what this plot shows you. And you can see there's two tracks here. This track gives you the offset Gregorian performance. This track gives you the prime focus performance. And just for reference, this is the nominal Meerkat. This is like the deepest sensitivity that's planned for LaDuma and for Mighty. So this is kind of the target you're trying to reach. So the nice thing is you can see that it is certainly reachable. And with offset Gregorian, you actually get to this sort of noise floor a lot earlier than you do with the prime focus. So it's actually quite interesting, the completely different behavior of these two curves. For a prime focus design, this thing kind of slopes off almost linearly in the slope log plot. So this basically says that for a prime focus, as you go further and further out, your noise will reduce steadily. Whereas for the offset Gregorian, you very quickly reach an optimal radius, and it's less than 10 degrees. So deconvolving further out than 10 degrees doesn't buy you very much, because you've already picked up. You actually pick up most of the signal here, pretty much at the horizon, and then you pick up very little for all this extent, and then you get quite a lot of it in the near side lobes.
So for the side lobe confusion, did you use? For example, if I ask the question, if I somehow know the first side lobe, I want to know what is the confusion noise coming from the higher side lobes.
Yeah, that's essentially this. That's what the spot tells you, right? So the first side lobe is here.
That's the first side.
I just use to find the units again.
So this is...
The vertical.
Well, this is... that's one Mikojansky there. That's Jansky. So this is the aggregate flux from all the sources. So for any given point, this shows you the aggregate flux from from sources outside that radius, as modulated by the primary beam, by the PSF, and by the time and frequency
beam. So it's the aggregate flux. So the noise would be this flux divided by the area that you're imaging.
No. It's the noise. It's the noise contribution. It's not aggregate flux. It's really the noise contribution.
RMS.
Yeah, RMS noise, as measured by imaging an empty field. So this is really how much noise you're going to see contributed by the entire sky outside that radius.
It's in transcripts because it's independent of your synthesized side
beam. Yes.
Oleg, how do you normalize it on the flux of the whole sky?
Sorry?
How did you normalize the flux of the total sky? I'm not sure I understood that.
But you don't. Well, you mean how do we go from our restricted simulation to
yes,
to the whole source?
You slice it open in donuts, etc. What's the flux for each donut? The total flux.
Well, you run a simulation for each donut, right? So each one of these points is actually one donut.
Yes, I understood that, but how much is the flux for each donut?
Well, that's what the point.
Whatever's in the MVSS.
Yeah. Whatever was the MVSS for that donut, that's what you put in. And then you apply a correction factor. So you use we use the SCAD simulation to say, okay, there's, I think the correction factor, the final one was like 0.7 or something. So 70% of the flux is on our simulation, and the last 30% we get out of extrapolating.
So what's the fractional bandwidth?
This is actually, this is 20 megahertz. This is 20 megahertz band in this particular simulation at around 1.4 gigahertz.
And this is using the Meerkat configuration?
This is the Meerkat configuration, eight hour synthesis.
Is there surface roughness in the telescope model that's calculated by EMSS?
The surface roughness?
Yeah.
No, because that would be different. That's calibration noise. I'm coming to that later in the talk. So this is just the you know, the perfect noise given a perfect dish, how much noise you get from the sky outside.
Right, but any real dish will have far side lobes that also have contributions from surface roughness of the dish. And
yeah. They'll be more random than this. I've got if you bear with me for a couple of slides.
One more question. What about feedback throughput?
I've got that. Give me two more slides, I'll answer both questions, okay? Well, I think actually these two slides are actually just a blow, a detail. So kind of just to relate what you're seeing here, the behavior of this curve, to the actual beam. What this curve tells you is that you're picking up a bunch of side load noise through this bit here at the horizon, past 75 degrees. That's the spillover patch from the secondary reflector. And then you pick up very little as you go all the way here. And then at the near end side lobes, that's where you get that nice little peak.
And the size of the primary beam is just how big is the actual 1 degree? Or?
It's a 2 degree field of view. So this is 2 degrees here, this patch. That's the purple patch.
And is it how many hour duration?
Eight hours.
8 hours around transit. Is that right?
8 hours around, yeah. It was a 40-40 declination 40 field, as far as I remember. Declination 30 didn't really work so well because of the...
And the real beam patterns should go out to 180 degrees rather than just 90.
In principle, they do, yeah. So this is... I have a new set of simulations where we put the full... where we actually applied horizon masking and used the whole sky out as opposed to... But it turns out that it changes very little. I mean, in log scale, you don't even see the difference. The rest of the sky adds so, you know, by the time you pass 90 degrees, you're attenuated down so hard that it barely makes a difference to the simulation. But I think really the thing to take away from this is the really different behavior between the offset Gregorian, like you see this flat shoulder in this performance curve, and the prime focus, right, where it goes like that. So with the prime focus design, you start picking up confusion noise via these guys, And you just pick it up as you go closer in. So it's much more more performance.
So this simulation doesn't include the rotation that Tim is asking.
This one does. Yeah, I'll show you in a second. I've got like all the options collected into a single plot. Another thing to take away from this is that, you know, if you want to compare prime focus offset Gregorian, if you need to image all the way out to here, then you're better off for the prime focus. If the performance you want to reach is here, then you're far better than offset Gregorian. It really gives you a much better close-in performance in terms of side lobes. Now, as for rotating, so this is the sort of the master plot where I put all options together. What you have here is, in red, that's the nominal offset Gregorian, the one you saw before. In the white dots, that's the nominal prime focus. Then we have, in stars, this is prime focus where we've turned off the sky rotation. And you can see that for the prime focus, it actually makes very little difference. Then there's another one for the prime focus where we do have sky rotation, and where we've also randomized the side lobes by rotating every dish to a random angle. And you can see you can get a bit of an improvement, you know, half an order of magnitude in places from that little trick. Right? So that's the three prime focus curves. Then the same three curves for the offset Gregorian. So this is the nominal one. Then you have the blue stars. This is an offset Gregorian in an equatorial mount. And this tells you that it's actually, you pay a little if you were to put an offset Gregorian in an equatorial mount. And then this is the one with the randomized side lobes, where I've rotated each dish to a random angle, which of course you cannot do with an offset Gregorian because you're kind of stuck with the feed on one of the other side of the dish. And the other two curves are for this is the shape design, these triangles here, and then there's a shape design with randomized side lobes, which nominally this gives you the absolute best performance, but there's another point that makes this thing more complicated, which I'm about to get to. Does this answer either the questions?
Well, I'm wondering if the randomization represents something more physical, or is it just a randomization of the perfect reflector case?
In this case, it's a randomization of the perfect reflector case, right. So we just rotate it. We did not do, yeah, in real life, your surface would indeed make it make it more random, but, you know, I don't...
Well, it'll also increase the amplitude rather than making it only more random.
Well, the problem is how do we're still thinking of what's the best way to simulate beam patterns like that, you know?
Right.
If I had some kind of mathematical scheme for taking a nominal beam and turning it into a integrated beam.
IEEE standards, I think, for what the mean side lobe level is for given surface roughness, residual surface roughness of the dish, like even sort of predictions, and then you could sort of tune,
right.
You know, maybe make the additive sum or something. Of
But then you still need to make
perfect one plus this.
I think, I mean, it's very likely you would have been limited by thermal deformations
rather than
partial surface manufacture.
That too.
And you will get, basically, you're going to get astigmatism and cone mount strengths due to trouble. So it's, you know, if you take low orders, then you can do no orders, dialing a bit of that.
That's
going to give you pretty close.
Well, the other interesting option is running ahead of a little bit. Andre Young is going to give a talk on related subjects. They've got a very interesting scheme for modeling primary beams. I'm thinking we could also, maybe we can return to this after Andre's talk. That would be good. But anyway, this is kind of the aggregate result, more or less, of the study and the main plot. There is one twist to this, however, right? Right now, this result pretty much implicitly assumes that if the image up to here, then we can actually deconvolve everything in the image perfectly. Now, we all know that that's a pipe dream. We never deconvolve everything perfectly. So what these curves give us are just a boundary in the performance. They give us the absolute limit that we can reach. Now, in practice, we are not quite going to get there. And for various, so there's always going to be some fraction of the sources that we cannot access, whether that's because they're too close to the noise. You know, as you get further out, they're going to be sinking into the noise. So how do we deconvolve them? They might be too complicated to deconvolve. And the other problem is that as you get into the side lobes, your side lobes become uncertain, right? Certainly a lot less certain than the main lobe. So again, you might not be able to deconvolve these sources at all. Now, I was at a bit of a... haven't had time to investigate this fully, really. So what I did was a simple rough simulation where I said, okay, let's just say we are. So what happens? The effect of this is to lock in some of the signal. So there's some side lobe confusion noise that gets locked in, and that's not going to go away no matter how big you make the image, right? So for a rough simulation, I said, okay, let's lock in the fainter 20%, and that's going to be a larger and larger proportion of sources as you go out because the primary beam attenuates them down. So let's just say some percent of sources gets locked in, and then you start getting curves like this. This is very preliminary, don't quote me on this because I still have to recheck the numbers. But what happens, because of that locked-in side lobe confusion noise, all your performance curves go asymptotic, right? So it turns out that, you know, the primary focus design doesn't actually go down to here, because at some point you've accumulated so much locked-in signal from your near inside lobes that going further out doesn't really buy you anything. So just for dramatic effect, compare it again to this plot. And of course, this depends very much on what X percent is here. And I actually forget what X percent is for this plot. Sorry, I just pulled it. This is the new slide, by the way, so wake up. And the other interesting thing is that, you know, you see, we had the shaped offset Gregorian and the unshaped offset Gregorian. And in these curves, the shaped offset Gregorian actually does somewhat better because it has lower far outside lobes. Now, once you've taken the locked-in signal into account, the shaped design actually does worse because it's got worse near inside lobes. So it locks in more of the signal already here. So deconvolving out to there doesn't really do doesn't really do much for you.
Is this contribution already weighted by the angular, I mean the area, so to speak, of the ring?
Yeah. Because this contribution is just it's a simulation of all the sources in the ring, basically. So we just put all the sources of all in the ring into the simulation, and that gives us the signal.
So it drops off as the ring grows, so to speak.
Well, the surface grows, but it drops off because your PSF drops off and because your primary beam drops off.
So the two cancel.
Yeah.
Why does the shaped design have bigger inner side lobes?
That would be a question for the dish designers. Does anyone know the answer?
I think the shape thing is trying to either to illuminate the secondary vector more hard or let them suffer at orbit.
You can shape it.
It's sort of optimization around sensitivity and side lobes.
So it's optimized for maximum sensitivity.
I think so.
That's right, yeah. So
but then you can shape it in many different ways.
You can
optimize for this.
Yes, but from that you do that, you can get bad trade-offs.
So it just needs to be traded off against
the cat's not shaped that beside the material.
Okay, here's another extremely preliminary result. This was all from Meerkat. You can ask the question, okay, how does this vary for different interferometers? How does this vary with the ray layout and size? So here's the same set of simulations for three additional layouts. So Westerbork, VLAB, and SK phase one. So I've taken those array layouts, but I've used the same dishes. So this is what you would get if you had Meerkat offset Gregorians in a Westerbork layout. And so this gives you, each plot contains four performance curves for, again, for the offset Gregorian case and for the prime focus case. So this is the Meerkat curve, again recognizable. This is the Westerbork curve. And then this is the VLA curve. And this is the SKA1 curve. And that's because your PSF, your far PSF side lobes, at least when you use natural weighting, your level of PSF side lobes goes down with the number of antennas. So if you have a decent layout, it's good to have, you know, the more antennas you throw at your layout, the further down you drive your PSF, the further down you drive your this term. But look at this. This is VLA. This is Meerkat. Meerkat has almost twice the number of antennas, roughly. But it does worse on this particular metric. And the reason for that, as far as I can tell, is the array layout. If you look, for example, at the histogram of the baseline length for the VLA and for Meerkat, for the VLA it's kind of a much flatter distribution. Whether Meerkat has a large bulge in the shorter baselines. Now, remember that this diffusion noise signal is also attenuated by time and frequency smearing, right? So longer baselines are going to see a lot less of it than shorter baselines. So if you have an array that's biased towards shorter and medium baselines, like Meerkat is, it will do worse than an array that's more spread out than the VLA is. So that's another interesting nugget to take out of it. So conclusions. This is only the first half of my talk.
Yep. Is that okay? Your time is up. You'll be on there.
Can we, because we were missing one talk, so can we expand a little bit? There were a lot of questions.
Okay.
I'm sure, I assure you this is also going to be very interesting. So the first confusion, that for conclusion, for less sensitive telescopes, you can ignore side lobe confusion noise. We have ignored it. But already at Meerkat sensitivities, it's becoming a dynamic range limitation. And for SKA, this is even more the case. You can view confusion noise as kind of a computing cost versus noise floor trade-off. You can drive it down, but it's convolving more, but that means you need bigger computers. And you can significantly influence side lobe confusion noise by your choice of primary beam. And in that sense, it's fortunate that we've gone for offset Gregorians without actually fully knowing this, because they do tend to work a little better. And finally, a well-designed large N layout is pretty much essential for deep sensitivities. You know, one of the best ways to suppress this confusion noise signal is by having more antennas in your array and having a decent layout where the distant PSF side lobes go down. But that's, of course, only half of the story. The second half is calibration noise. And basically, the context here, of course, you know, if you follow this meeting, then you know that we've been very successful at eliminating all sorts of dynamic direction-dependent effects by applying direction-dependent solutions. So we started with peering, but now we have sage call, now we have differential gains. Lots of different approaches. They all work really well. They eliminate sources completely. But when we say eliminate completely, what we actually mean is that we're driving these sources down into the thermal noise. And what I think this actually means is that we're sweeping them under the carpet. So another thing that grew out of these simulations, I got to wondering, what do we sweep under the carpet, and can we quantify that somehow? And will it come back to haunt us later, all this sweeping under the carpet business? So here's what I came up with. I call it distilling the artifacts. So again, we do a simulation. We use the NVSS, and we use SCADs to make a very deep LSM for a small field of view. So this is just a 2-degree field of view. Just a normal looking patch of sky, and then I've artificially added a couple of Wangyansky sources at the half power point. These I call the contaminator sources. So these are the sources we're going to worry about. And then we make two full simulations, including beams, including pointing errors. So pointing errors are actually the source of direction dependent effect in this simulation, the only source. And including a random gain term. And we make two simulations. This is the critical part. We make one simulation that's full. We take the entire LSM, we add thermal noise, and that's our simulated data. And then we make one simulation that's partial. What we take is we just take the two contaminators and nothing else. That's the only thing in our sky model. But we apply the same set of gain errors and the same set of pointing errors to these two contaminators. So now we have these two parallel sets of visibilities. And then we can go play with them. So the first thing we do is we run self-cal and we obtain gain solutions on our full simulation, right? So this kind of simulates the calibration process. Then we image the residuals. The residuals are going to contain artifacts, of course. They're going to contain thermal noise, and they're going to contain fainter sources that we haven't put into your standard, right? So here's how can you tease these things apart. Well, remember, we made a second set of visibilities where we just have the two contaminators. So now what we can do is we can take a model with the two contaminators, apply the gain solutions that we obtained at this step, and subtract it from that simulation. And then what this results in is kind of the distilled artifacts. This is the flux from the two contaminators that's left over, that's not going to be subtracted, that's going to be left over in your image. So if you make an image of these residuals, this tells you exactly how much your contaminators are going to leave in your final interferometric image. And here's what it looks like. So it's not too bad, actually, right? I mean, we've had, for this particular simulation, the RMS is 4.2 microjansky. Of course, critically, it's very much non-random, right? You can see here's where one contaminator set, here's where the other contaminator set. So this is what you have left in your image. Most of it will not be visible below the noise. You will see some faint artifacts around the sources. So in real life, if this was a real life observation, you're going to say, okay, let's go apply direction dependent solutions to these guys. See if you can subtract them better. And when you do that in real life, you see perfectly clean images, these, as long as they're point sources, as long as, you know, we get the solution intervals right, we can really get rid of them. We get noise limited images. So I can do it in this simulation. And of course, then I can apply the same trick. I can again go back to my visibilities of just the contaminator sources, apply gain solutions to them, apply differential gain solutions to them, subtract them out, see what's left. And this is what's left. So if you compare the two images, this is the artifacts we have left when we just do self-cal. This is the artifacts we have left when we apply differential gains to the two sources. So you can see, well, RMS noise has only dropped by a factor of 2, but this is certainly a lot more noise-like. So you think, okay, this is good. We can quantify calibration noise from these two sources. What's the big deal as long as it stays below the thermal noise? Well, it is a big deal if it's non-Gaussian. So consider a deep survey like LADOMA or MITEI, where we're going to be doing multiple repeat pointings of the same field. And in that field, we're going to have to remove the bright sources. And then we start adding up all these observations together, driving the thermal noise down. Are these guys going to add up in the same fashion? Well, you can probably guess that no, they're not. So yeah, I was getting ahead of myself. This is the problem. 5,000 hours split up into many different observations. So for each pointing, you're going to have independent, direction-dependent effect solutions. So pretty much by definition, right? You come back to the same field, you're going to have a different DTE because all the effects are different. So for each pointing, you're actually going to generate a totally independent set of these artifacts. So the question is, once you start combining these things, well, you know how your thermal noise is going to go down, and you know you're going to get here after 5,000 hours. So what are the artifacts going to do? Well, we can use the same simulator. Basically, we just repeat the distillation experiment. We just repeat it multiple times with a different set of instrumental errors every time. And then we add up the distilled maps. And this is where it gets interesting. So this is the residual map after one distillation. RMS noise is 2.6 microjansky. After 10 distillations, you start adding these things up. You see the contaminators pop right back out. Which is not really surprising, because if you think about it, this thing has to be modulated by the PSF. So sooner or later, you're going to start seeing the PSF shape popping up. And of course, after 10 distillations, you would expect noise, Gaussian noise, to have gone down by a factor of just over 3, right? But you can see it's only about a factor of 2. So this thing, depending on our, you know, on how well we can control pointing error, this thing might actually prove to be a bigger dynamic range limit than the previous subject on side-lobe confusion noise. Sure.
So you still have two contaminating sources here, and yet it seems like one is showing up much more.
In the yes, it's sitting in a different part of the primary beam.
One is in the center, the other one is
the center. No, the center is here, but remember this is an offset Gregorian. Oh, right. So the beam is actually, it's passing through different parts of the primary beam over our 8-hour track. And but it's good that you asked this question, because of course then you can say, does this depend on the primary beam pattern? And turns out, yes, it does. So if I repeat exactly the same experiment for the prime focus design, you can actually see the shape is slightly different, but the RMS noise is actually quite a bit higher for the prime focus case, right? It's about a factor of 3 worse. So the way I interpret this is that the prime focus design is 3 times as sensitive to pointing error, to the same amount of pointing error, because it was the same amount of pointing error that was introduced into the simulations, than an offset Gregorian design. And as best as I can explain it, that probably comes about to the fact that, you know, here, as you mispoint this pattern on the sky, and here your sources are moving along a fairly smooth surface, so the gain doesn't change nearly as much as it does here, where things are rougher. That's, you know, that's the best explanation I can offer for it. But it's a very real effect. I can, you know, you can see it just quite well here.
So you have not included if you know the primary beam, you know how the gains are varying.
Well, it would be a good plot. We should actually plot in the original simulation. You know, yeah. I should probably just make a plot of that of the gain variation per each source in the original simulation. Anyway, so those are my final conclusions. So all calibration, you know, including direction-dependent solutions, are going to leave non-Gaussian artifacts buried in your thermal noise, right? And for deep surveys, this may become a dynamic range limitation. One thing to think about, for example, for Meerkat, you know, when we do deep surveys, we should probably schedule them for, you know, optimal times when the wind load is the least, because you can see that for, you know, if you're doing something shallow, then pointing may be a non-issue. For deep surveys, you probably want to optimize things for favorable conditions. And this is the other interesting thing, right? The prime focus design actually gives you 3 times worse response to pointing error than offset Gregorian. But definitely, we need more study of this. So I shall leave you on that note. Thank you very much.
I wonder if you care to take along the sun in your...
we talked about that last time. I've taken that on board, but I just haven't had time to implement it.
It's an excellent messy one.
It is an excellent suggestion, yes. The sound has to be in there eventually. All right.
Do any of your trends change if you think about wideband beam sensitivity?
I haven't done wideband yet, because those EM simulations are pretty expensive. So to do wideband, you need a set of simulations that's phased fairly. So that's somewhere in the future still. At the moment, this is narrowband.
A related question, do you know how does it scale with frequency? Does it scale or does it change very much? Just linearly scales with frequency or changes very much?
Does what? Which effect?
The E-term. The aperture illumination, does it to the first order just scale with frequency or changes even to the first order?
Probably scales to the first order, you can think of it just as the beam scaling with frequency, right? Whereas the smallness changes the frequency, I don't
know. Yeah, I'm just trying to understand the cause of the non-Gaussian artifacts. And within this relation, you're sort of solving for the pointing errors.
No, we're solving for direction-dependent gains directly. Oh,
direction-dependent gains. And some, are you solving it for at some sort of time interval?
Yes. So this is for a given time interval.
So as you sort of compress this time interval, you're slightly reducing errors, thermal errors essentially, but that might actually cause, that might decorrelate the non-Gaussian errors. So you look into compressing this time interval.
No, I made the time interval small enough to make noise limited maps, because that's basically been the practice up till now, right? We get to the noise and we stop. Of course, if you make the time interval even shorter, all sorts of other nasties come up, because you're basically putting more and more degrees of freedom into your calibration model. So
nasties might be Gaussian, you see. And if they're Gaussian, they're going to compress down.
Yeah, but then you're doing all sorts of nasty other stuff, such as suppressing sources that aren't in your calibration model and so on. So shorter solution intervals are not really the answer, because they produce a whole lot of other problems. But, okay, yeah, you're right, I might make this one Gaussian. But then we're throwing the baby out of the bathwater.
But if you're solving a pointing error instead of direction-dependent gains, you can increase the solution interval very substantially.
Yeah, that's something I should try. I hope Buchenbaum can basically repeat the same experiment for pointing errors.
Yeah.
But you know, we've always had the problem of, simply because we don't always know the beams well enough, when we start solving for pointing errors, we always leave more artifacts than when we do directed direction-dependent solutions. Right.
If not knowing the primary beams will get you one way or the other, so that you got to know.
Yeah.
I mean, even solving for these will not get you there. Tim?
Anytime you give a talk, which has a comparison of x versus y, someone in the audience is going to say, well, I'm giving z instead of y. So I'm going to follow that. It's very dependent upon, your conclusion is very dependent upon you know, what prime focus beam actually looks like, I think. And a more interesting comparison, I think more demanding comparison, would be of a phased array beam. If you were to give you a really good phased array beam, which was designed to get the curve down as low as possible.
Right. I think it would be an excellent project. Yeah. If you can get me those beams, then it's fairly straightforward to rerun the same comparisons.
Yeah.
It's just a question of generating the beam patterns. That's...
Yes. I'm looking at Max.
he's ignoring you.
Okay. I think we'll move on.